This museum is publicly funded by our tax dollars. Our means both men and women. The weekly attendance at this institution is 60% female. The painting and appreciation classes are 70% female. Yet this great cultural institution represents only two female artists. And its current offering, The Age of Napoleon, represents no female artists. No one's stopping.
Women artists excluded from this exhibition include Elizabeth Vigée-Lebrun, 1742 to 1855, painter of over 660 portraits, and Marie Benoist, 1748 to 1826.
No more master penises! No more master penises! No more master penises!
Peter!
At 2 o'clock this afternoon, my sisters and I will march on the curator's office and demand equal representation for our vision. We urge you to join us.
That was terrific. Just great. Hello, Peter Patron.
Heidi, I'm afraid some of our group may have gone to the wrong location. Clara and I will go have a look around.
Right, and I'll stand here and beat up any beast who dares go in there with a Rembrandt or a Rubens.
Peter, this is serious.
Serious? This is urgent. There I was in my lonely intern cell, reminiscing about the 300 stab wounds I had stitched up last night, and contemplating taking two Quaaludes for my slight sore throat, when who should be on the payphone to tell me she can't see me because she's only going to be in Chicago for 4 hours, but my innocent youth, my lost love, the lovely and talented Miss Heidi Holland.
Thank you for coming, I think.
You think? I'm the only one who came.
You're a great friend.
And I'm a committed and selfless friend. Do you know what we're missing by being out here? Do you realize that after today we won't have Dick Nixon to kick around anymore? So, are you just going to stand here and wait for a few women to buy more paints and finish a few masterpieces for this sexist, chauvinistic, creepo institution to exhibit?
You heard Debbie. We're marching on the curator's office.
Debbie? Her name is Debbie. Anyone who wears that much black and silver is not a Debbie. Surely she's a Deborah. Heidi, you should change your name to Heiderin or Heidegwin. Then people would take you more seriously.
You've become cruel in my absence.
Not cruel. Dyspeptic. I've developed a violent, narcissistic personality disorder.
You have?
Don't worry, my darling. According to my mental health friends, we are heading into a decade of self-obsession. I'm merely at the forefront of the movement. And speaking of the self-obsessed and satisfied, how's Poopsie?
Scoop? He's in Washington clerking for the Supreme Court.
He isn't running for president yet. His parents must be ashamed of him. Harry! Scoop is dead in this house, do you hear me? Dead!
Actually, he and my friend Susan are clerking for the same judge.
So you're still in touch?
But I'm not involved with him. I just like sleeping with him.
What a perky 70s kind of gal you are. You can separate your sexual needs from your emotional dependencies. Heidi, if you tell me that you secrete endorphins when you run, I am going to march straight into the curator's office and demand a full armor retrospective.
Don't bother. They're already planning that. Are you okay?
Actually, I'm afraid I'm feeling sort of distant from you.
Peter, I was writing my dissertation.
I'm not criticizing you, I'm just telling you how I'm feeling. I haven't seen you in 8 months.
Peter, you need a girlfriend.
Please don't find me a girlfriend.
We have got to get you a girlfriend. You've never liked any of mine.
I never liked any of your women friends. But I did like Fran, the furry physicist from Ann Arbor.
Fran is unavailable. I promise I'll find someone.
Heidi, I don't play on your team.
So what? Susan says no man really plays on our team, and no man isn't threatened by our true potential.
Is Susan the one who used to roll up her skirts at school dances and give herself stigmatas in the waist with straight pins?
She's become a radical counselor shepherdess.
Really? Good for her. And I've become a liberal, homosexual pediatrician.
Well, Actually, what I mean is, she was living on a women's health and legal collective, but she then went to clerking for the Supreme Court, but she realized she prefers...
Sheep?
Yeah.
She realized she prefers sheep. Makes sense. And I prefer Stanley.
Who?
My friend's name is Stanley Zink. He's a child psychiatrist from Johns Hopkins, but he's thinking of quitting to study with Merce Cunningham. The sad thing is, Stanley's too old to join the company, and Miss Merce isn't getting any younger either. Anyway, I'm thinking of replacing him with a waiter I met last week. We share a mutual distrust of Joni Mitchell. I would have told you all this sooner, but I thought we deserved something more intimate than a phone call, so I chose the Chicago Art Institute.
I wish Debbie would get back.
Why in God's name would you wish that Debbie would get back?
Because you're being impossible.
How am I being impossible?
You're being impossible about Susan and her political ideals.
But I want to celebrate Susan and her political ideals.
Fuck off, Peter.
Heidi, I'm gay, okay? I sleep with Stanley Zink, MD. And my liberation, my pursuit of happiness, and the pursuit of happiness of other men like me is just as politically and socially valid as hanging a couple goddamn paintings because they were signed by someone named Nancy, Gladys, or Gilda. And that is why I came to see you today. I am demanding your equal time and consideration.
Women in art! Women in art! Women in art!
Thank God, Debbie's back.
I think it's time we made our move. The Coalition for Women's Art will now be marching on the curator's office. Please join us.
Women in art!
Women in art! Women...
I find your ironic tone both paternal and caustic. I'm sorry, I can't permit you to join us. This is a women's march.
But I thought our point was that this was our cultural institution. Men and women, him included.
Heidi, you know this is a women's march.
Heidi, you march, and I'll wait for you here.
I'm sorry. I can't leave my friend.
God, I despise manipulative men.
Me too.
Suit yourself, Heidi.
Women in art! Women in art!
It's a shame she didn't let me march. I know the curator.
Really? What team does he play on?
Guess. Heidi. I know somewhere you think my worldview is small and personal, and that yours resonates for generations to come.
I'm gonna hit you.
Come on, I dare you. Put up your dukes. That's for having distorted sexual politics.
Correct.
And that's because your liberation is better than mine.
Correct again.
And that's for being paternal and caustic. Ow!
That's for being... so goddamn...
narcissistic?
No.
Supercilious?
No.
Sounds like...
give up. And that's for liking to sleep with men more than women. And that's for not being desperately and hopelessly in love with me.
And that's for making me feel guilty!
I did.
Yes. And that's... for not remembering our 10-year anniversary.
We've known each other 10 years.
Well, 9. But we don't look it. Heidi, for the first time in my life, I am optimistic. We might just have very happy lives. With enough women's art for everybody. Just don't lose your sense of humor. Or marry that poop.
Scoop. Peter... I'd like to meet Stanley Zink, Dr. Dancer.
But not imminently, I hope. I left out one other thing. I asked the waiter to meet me here for lunch today, and take a deep breath. He's actually shown up.
He's cute.
He's adorable.
He's okay.
Hi!
Hi!
Mark, this is Heidi.
Hi.
Heidi. Hi. Mark.
Hi.
So, what happened?
Oh, it was almost sad in a way. He was sweating and everything. I wonder if I'll ever want anything as much as Nixon wanted to be president.
Sure you will.
What?
Me. You'll want me. Everything went great here. I antagonized Debbie and the entire Women in Art delegation, and subsequently Heidi inflicted me with brutal beatings.
Really?
It's true. But Mark, you still can make it up to me.
I can.
We still can march on the curator's office.
But what about Debbie? This is a women's march!
Mark, I'm demanding your equal time and consideration. Women in art! Women in art!
Women in art! Women in art! Women in art! Women in art!
Susan, who are all those people?
Well, Molly, Heidi's my oldest friend. Peter's the doctor. I don't know the bride. And the groom is a prick.
Susan, I don't think we're in Montana anymore.
Do you, Scoop, take Lisa Friedlander to be your bride?
Well, I feel ambivalent about her, but I am blocked emotionally, and she did go to good schools, comes from a very good family, and is not particularly threatening, so... Yeah, I do. Besides, it's time for me to get married.
And do you, Lisa, take Scoop? Rabbi, I idolize Scoop because he is as brilliant and will be as rich as my daddy, whom I also idolize. And I am a slight masochist, although I do come from the best Jewish family in all of Memphis.
Honestly, I have never seen a less romantic-looking bride.
Peter, she looked very tasteful.
She looked like a lace tampon.
And those bridesmaids look like flying buttresses.
I'm sure she's a very nice person.
You're right, Molly. I'm sure she is a very nice person, too.
I'm surprised Scoop married someone so bland.
Susan, do your sisters know that you are capable of calling another woman bland?
We should go in there and shake hands. What is with you today? I'd marry her.
She had no meat on her.
I love you, Molly.
They'll be very happy together. She's perfect for Scoop.
How do you know?
Are you the groom?
Yes.
I heard you're a prick.
Hi, Susan.
This is my friend, Molly McBride, from the Women's Health and Legal Collective.
Hey, Sister Shepherdess, is always a pleasure. And you must be the pediatrician.
Mazel tov.
Heidela speaks fondly of you. I can't understand why she hasn't introduced us before.
Heidela, why have you kept us apart?
I wish you'd all go to the reception. You're the most interesting people here.
Well, heck, I'll go in. I always like a good party.
I think our continued presence here is really up to Heidi.
Well, Heidi's not saying anything. That means she wants to stay. Come on, Mol. We'll whore like nobody's ever whored. Maybe we can convince the bride to dump him and join us in Montana. Susan's angry with me.
Susan's crazy.
No, she's not.
She's a fanatic and she's crazy. Did you know she was voted one of the top 10 most attractive new women in Washington? I could have been interested in her.
Does Susan know this? She might drown Molly.
Susan's not involved with Molly.
Only in her heart she lusts for other women.
Susan's very committed. She's thinking of going to business school so the collective can become self-sufficient.
She'll be on Wall Street in 2 years, trust me.
Are you in love?
Excuse me?
I like to think that when two people our age get married, they are in love.
Peter's very romantic.
Woman, are you two an item now?
No.
Yes!
Makes sense. Lisa marries a nice Jewish lawyer. Heidi marries a warm Italian pediatrician. So interchangeable. So, to answer your question, am I in love? Sure, why not?
Why not?
Sweetie, this is Peter Petrone and his fiancée Heidi. Peter's a pediatric resident at Bellevue.
Hey there, how nice to see you.
I was just telling Peter that we are hoping for a large family.
It's not very common these days.
I have always known I want to be a mom.
I guess that's pretty embarrassing, isn't it?
Sweetie, do you think that's embarrassing?
No, sweetie, of course not.
Well, I am going to keep up my illustration work.
Yes, Lisa's books are very popular.
Wait a second, are you Lisa Friedlander, illustrator of King Ginger the Lion?
You know King Ginger?
The best medical text in this country is King Ginger Goes to the Hospital.
She's terrific, isn't she?
There'll be a riot in my waiting room if you stop working.
Well, we'll see.
Don't be such a little piggy. Dr. Patron, would you join me for my first dance? Obviously, my husband has decided to be antisocial at his own wedding.
I'm being what?
Had it. Don't you hate that we can only get a reaction out of our men when they feel competitive? I guess that's why it's so much fun to push them around. Oh, sweetie, one more thing. There are two women I don't recognize waltzing around the dance floor together. Aunt Florence thinks they might be interlopers. Shake your booty, Doctor!
See ya.
Did she just say, shake your booties, Doctor?
God, I'm so unhappy!
She must be very talented.
Why did you let me do this?
Me! Why did I let you do this? I had nothing to do with
it. Yes, you did. And are you really marrying this doctor?
Maybe.
Seems like a nice enough guy.
He's a wonderful guy. He's also gay.
What?
Anyways, I'm sort of seeing someone, sort of living with someone.
So, there is he. I want to have a look.
I didn't want you to see him. I didn't want you to have a look.
Is he quality goods?
He's an editor.
An editor?
I met him at work. I'm writing a book of essays.
Academic?
Sort of.
Art history?
Sort of.
Sounds like there could be a mini-series potential here.
Well, it's called And the Light Floods In from the Left and Other Overcommitments. Essays on art and women.
Sort of Marcusean.
Well, it's sort of social observant. Sort of humorous. Well, it's sort of a point of view.
Heidel, you're shredding the napkin. Aunt Florence will never recover from who's been at the pier today. Look, I didn't ask you to clean the room, I just told you not to shred. Perhaps you should spend some time on the collective in Montana, you know, liberate yourself. So, who's this editor?
I don't have to answer these questions.
Actually, Heidi, I'm a lawyer who's about to become a journalist again, so yes, actually, it would be easier if just answered my questions.
What do you mean you're about to become a journalist again?
I'm starting a magazine.
What magazine?
No, I answered your questions, now you answer mine. Who's this editor?
Christ.
Oh, come on, I'm just trying to have a pleasant conversation with you. I'm concerned about you. I care about you. Where do you go to school?
Trinity.
Trinity, Trinity Cambridge, Trinity Hartford.
Trinity Hartford.
Oh, gosh! You're sort of living with an editor who went to Trinity College Hartford?
You certainly have come a long way since the Liberated Earth.
What did I say? I didn't say anything. Where does he edit?
Hustler.
He should only be half as creative as an editor of Hustler and an eighth as well endowed.
You don't even know him.
Yes, I do. Where does he edit? Knopf?
Do you interrogate Lisa like this?
No, I sort of know who Lisa lives with. Simon and Schuster?
No.
Harper and Row?
I don't know.
Oh, it's Harper and Row. I knew it. Way to go, Rosenbaum.
I hate this. I really hate this.
No, you don't. Otherwise, you wouldn't have come.
Peter wanted to come. He said, if I witnessed your ritual, it would put an end to an era. And Susan, for some insane reason, she wanted to come too. This is all irrelevant. I'm thinking of writing my book in England. I applied for a Fulbright.
Violet, just because you haven't won this particular round doesn't mean you have to completely drop out of the match.
You still use lousy construction.
Yes, I do. And that's what makes me so much more interesting than the editor.
Fuck you.
And you still use foul language.
You don't.
My wife doesn't like it.
Oh, well, clearly she's quality goods.
You don't understand, do you?
Oh, I think I do.
No, you don't, but I can explain it to you. Say we married, and I asked you to devote, say, the next 10 years of your life to making me a family, a home, a life so secure that I could, with some confidence, go out into the world each day and get an A. You'd say no. You'd say, why can't we be partners? Why can't we both go out into the world and get an A? And you'd be absolutely valid and correct.
But Lisa...
Do I love her, as your nice friend asked? She's the best I can do. Is she an A plus like you? No. But I don't want to come home to an A plus. A minus maybe, but not an A plus.
Scoop, we're out of school. We're in life. You don't have to grade everything.
I just couldn't dangle you anymore, Hydala. And that's why I got married today. So
now it's all my fault.
Sure it is. You want other things in life than I do.
Really? Like what?
Self-fulfillment, self-determination, self-exaggeration.
That's what you want.
Right! And you'd be competing with me.
Scoop.
What?
Forget it.
What, baby?
I...
It's either or.
That is simply not true.
You don't like grades, then fuck grades. Let's try numbers.
I thought you don't use foul language.
I don't. Unless it's useful. On a scale from 1 to 10, if you aim for a 6 and get a 6, everything will work out. But if you aim for a 10 in all things and get a 6, you're going to be very disappointed. And unfortunately, that's why you quality time gals are going to be a generation of very disappointed women. Interesting, exemplary, even sexy. But basically unhappy. The ones who open doors usually are.
But you're willing to settle for a secure 6.
I just have more important things to worry about.
Your magazine?
Just things. It's all home cooking and crock pots that you bought us. I was hurt by that, by the way. It's not a very personal gift.
I'll send a Mr. Coffee. Bye, Scoop. Congratulations.
Sorry I disappointed you.
I don't give grades.
I told you in New Hampshire, you'd be the one this would all make such a difference to.
I've yet to torch lingerie.
I'm talking life choices.
I haven't made them yet.
Yes, you have. Or we'd be getting married today. I never meant to hurt you.
I have to go. Or Peter will abandon me for a waiter.
Really? But he's a well-educated man. He went to Williams.
Williams men like to come home to well-set tables, too.
Fish is dumpling.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lisa and Scoop have requested this recording of their favorite song.
Darling, you
chips.
Sam Cook.
A plus content.
A plus form.
I love you, Heidi. I will always love you.
Oh, please.
I missed you, dude. I missed you, dude.
Cabot's Perry, 1848 to 1933, was, along with the better-known Mary Gassot and Baltimore Sell, a major influence in American Impressionism. Her painting, Lady with a Bowl of Violets, Lilla went through a little-known hostility period. Actually, the painting you're looking at is Judith Beheading Holofernes by Artemisia Gentileschi. Please bear with me. My TA is taking the law boards today. Thank you. Lady with a Bowl of Violets. Notice how the cool blues and violets change to warmer oranges, lighting up the collar of the rather flimsy negligee. Change flimsy to flouncy, but Lilla cops out when she gets to the head. Suddenly, we're back at traditional portraiture. The painting I prefer is Lady in Evening Dress, painted in 1911. Closer to her mentor Monet, Lilla is willing to lose her edges in favor of paint and light. Go, Lilla! Now, let's compare for a moment Cabot's Lady with Lily Martin Spencer's Fading Rose. There's something uniquely female about these paintings, and I'm not talking about their lovely qualities, overall technique, and delicate charm. Oh, please. What strikes me is that both ladies seem to be slightly removed from the occasions at hand. They appear to watch closely, but ease the way for the others to join in. I suppose it's really not unlike being an art historian. In other words, being neither the painter or the casual observer, but rather a highly informed spectator.